Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The issue of price gouging within the pharmaceutical industry was thrust into the national spotlight last week, but the issue is far more complex than a hedge fund manager marking up one drug. The entire industry's been doing this for decades, and we'll tell you why they keep getting away with it. And because of Eric Holder's refusal to go after banking criminals, the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico has been the victim of some of the most egregious crimes by the big banks. And so far, no one is being held accountable. We'll bring you the details. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
We're now in the last few days of our Free Speech TV pledge drive, and we're very close to meeting our goal. We're still a little bit short, so we need everyone's help to get us across that finish line. So again tonight, I issue the following challenge to our audience. Let's raise $1,000 in the next half hour. We've done it before, and we could do it again. If we can all come together to get to that $1,000 mark, free speech will be able to reach their goal and probably even pass it. I have faith in our Ring of Fire audience, and that's an easy goal that we should be able to hit. Just go online to freespeech.org and pledge to help to support independent, honest news journalism. You can also call our hotline, 877-378-8669, and donate over the phone. Your support helps to keep information flowing, and together we can take back the media and expand the reach of Free Speech TV. Free speech does not take any corporate money, and that's why your financial support is so important to us, because you can help protect free speech today with a donation. All of the other major cable news networks, Fox, MSNBC, and CNN, they're all under the thumb of corporate shareholders and advertisers who get to dictate what makes it onto the air. The viewers then get a watered-down version of the news that leaves out vital information. The hosts on those networks are accountable to those shareholders. But those of us on Free Speech TV are only accountable to you, our viewers. Free Speech TV is your voice, and we need your financial support to continue delivering quality news and opinion each day. Ring of Fire began as a radio program in 2004, and it was started because we were tired of the softened news coming out of the corporate media and their focus on infotainment rather than on focusing on fostering intelligent dialogue. In late 2012, we made the decision to join Free Speech TV, and it's one of the best decisions that we've made in our 11 years on the air. Free speech has given us a way to reach the largest audience possible and to tell the stories that the corporate media won't cover. Free Speech TV is our home, and we're asking for your support to help keep free speech growing. The network has a lot of new ideas and projects that they want to begin working on, projects that are going to make the network even better than it is right now. But we can't move forward without your support. And there's something in it for you, too. You can also get some really great items for donating. With a pledge of $60, you'll get the Corporations Are Not People Free Speech TV stamp. A donation of $120 will get you two Ring of Fire mugs, a pledge of $240, and you'll receive a Free Speech TV bear with the Free Speech TV family 10-button set, and for a donation of $360, you'll get the Free Speech TV bear with the Free Speech TV 10-button set, and the Corporations Are Not People Free Speech TV stamp. We only reach out a few times a year, and we only have a couple days left in this pledge drive, so please help out the network in any way that you can. Thank you for your support. You know, last week, Martin Shkreli managed to make the entire United States angry by buying the rights to a generic drug and then raising the price by over 5,000% overnight. What Shkreli did is deplorable, but he didn't invent that scheme. That's how Big Pharma's been operating for decades. For more on this, let's check in with Howard Nations. Howard, what Martin Shkreli did last week, you know, they now say, okay, well, we're going to change it back or we're going to lower the price. We still haven't seen that, But that's because this is not a Martin Shkreli scheme. This guy did not invent this. He's not the first person to ever try to do this. And yes, it's a horrible action, but we're seeing the pharmaceutical industry do this on a phenomenal scale. And I guess the latest target that they're going after is generic drugs, which are, you know, right, always cheaper, always the go-to drugs for most people. And now pharmaceutical industry is trying to do the same thing to get more bang out of their buck. What's happening with the generic industry?
Well, as you know, generics are the byproduct of brand name drugs. The pharmaceutical industry gets a 20-year patent on their brand name drugs and the exclusive rights to manufacture it. When a generic comes out after that 20-year period, this is important, they have to have the same ingredients as the brand name drug. So there's no research and development cost to generics, and they can sell at a much lower price. So think about that. Ask your doctor for generic drugs. They have to have the same ingredients, but doctors play along with the pharmaceutical companies and prescribe the brand names ad infinitum. So why are the generic prices rising as they are? As you say, the pharmaceutical industry has new schemes. They're buying generics, they're controlling the distribution, they're raising prices, and they're increasing their profits. The poster child for this is Martin Shkreli that you just mentioned. He's a 32-year-old former hedge fund manager who started touring pharmaceuticals when he bought Daraprim, which is a drug that fights parasitic infections in babies and AIDS and cancer patients. It sold for $13.50 a pill. He raised the price to $750 per pill. He justified this when he was questioned about it, saying, "I bought this to make a profit." The drug was originally marketed in 53 at $1 a pill. Turing raised the price. He controlled the distribution. The prescriptions were 12,700 per year in 2010. They've dropped to 8,800 now after he raised the price. Turing has now said, "Yeah, I'll drop the price," but it's because he yielded to public pressure and boycotting. It's not because the FDA did anything. It's not because Congress did anything. It's because the public got on him about it. We see this all the time in the pharmaceutical industry. He's not by himself.
So what we've seen right now is we have the big pharmaceutical companies. They're coming in, and maybe it's not the big pharmaceutical companies. Maybe it's just a larger generic company coming in, consolidating these generic drug companies, raising prices. You know, we've seen this across the board. That's what Martin Shkreli was hoping to do before the public caught on. But right, what the public needs to understand, though, again, his actions absolutely horrible, but this is what the industry does. I mean, you know, the United States, we pay more for a prescription drug, any drug. Go to the drugstore, pick one off the shelf and compare it to the price of it overseas, across the border, wherever, we're going to pay more. And I guess the biggest question here, Howard, is why? Why are we paying a 10,000% markup on some drugs, whereas, you know, Canada may pay a 50% markup, UK may pay 100%. Why so high here?
Well, if you look at Celebrex, for example, a very common drug, in Canada it sells for $51, US for $330. Gleevec, which is for leukemia patients, sells for $1,141 in Canada, $8,500 in the United States. Nexium, one of the most commonly used drugs, $30 in Canada, $306 in the United States. The reason for the disparity is that the government grants monopoly. Now, in a free market, competitors eliminate price gougers. In the United States, the government protects price gougers. The public and the press are the ones that forced Daraprim to reduce their prices. Had nothing to do with capitalism, nothing to do with free markets, everything to do with lobbying and government lapdogs. And basically, there are four villains in this: the pharmaceutical companies who gouge, the politicians who are their lapdogs who let them get away with absolutely anything they want, the FDA who refused to enforce the rules, and the doctors who continue to prescribe brand name drugs at high prices when generics are available with exactly the same compound. So that's how it happens.
So, okay, we understand now that the United States is paying more money, but let me play the other side. Isn't the reason we pay more money because they're spending so much on research and development? I mean, that's the argument you hear. So we're just paying for the research and development. It's an expensive process, so we, the United States, pay for it. Is that true?
Well, let's talk about research and development. In 2013, the last year we have statistics on this, there were $329.2 billion in pharmaceutical sales. 9 out of 10 of the biggest pharmaceutical companies spend more on marketing than they do on research and development. Johnson & Johnson is the biggest of those. They spent $17.5 billion on marketing, only $8.2 billion on research and development. But significantly, 8 times as much was spent on marketing to doctors and hospitals than was spent on marketing to the public. They spent $3 billion marketing to consumers, $24 billion marketing to doctors and to hospitals. The United States is the only country that allows direct consumer marketing and does not regulate drug prices. People have to understand that many doctors make very big money directly off of the pharmaceutical companies. And the lie is so huge about research and development because they're not researching to cure. They're researching with the express target of increased profits.
So, Howard, what's the FDA's role in all of this? I mean, I know they're supposed to be testing these drugs, making sure they're safe, making sure Big Pharma is on the up and up. But, you know, when it comes to prices or what they're actually creating, they don't really have any kind of role in that, do they?
No, they really don't. And the fact is that the industry is self-regulated when it comes to honesty and when it comes to their testing. And the profits are so large that they don't hesitate to engage in deceptive promotion. They don't do adequate warning. They have inadequate disclosures of side effects. They do fake studies. They hide regular study results. They market with known defects. There are 100,000 deaths a year that are attributed to adverse effects of pharmaceuticals. The FDA does nothing to control them. The only controls they have are litigation, where lawyers sue, they prove the defects, they prove the deception, they settle cases with the victims, the government steps in and takes the information from the lawyers, and they impose billions of dollars in fines on the companies, but the companies make so much money, they just pay the fines and move on to the next one. The way this happens is we have government by lobbyists. The pharmaceutical industry leads all industries with $171 million in lobbying in 2013. They're the largest contributors to Congress and to all politicians, and they reap the biggest profits. Possibly the biggest taxpayer ripoff in lobbying history, the Medicare scam. It started with the Bush administration, who had Thomas Scully as the representative, the head of Medicare, representing the Congress, representing Medicare, and negotiating with the Congress over the new pharmaceutical bill. He, in fact, instead of negotiating, he collaborated with Billy Tozen, who was the congressional committee chair, and they conspired to outlaw Medicare from negotiating with the drug manufacturers on the price of drugs. That is so outrageous, especially for Medicare, because Medicare is famous for how cheap they are with physicians and hospitals and laboratories, but they overpay exponentially for drugs. After the bill passed, Tozen immediately resigned from Congress and took at least 15 congressional staffers and officials who worked on the bill with him into lucrative jobs in Big Pharma. Tozen himself became head of Pharma and at $2 million a year. Now, that's a pretty well-known story. It was covered on 60 Minutes. What's not so well-known is that Tozen also stuck around and negotiated with Obama. He visited the White House 6 times as the president of Big Pharma and kept that no negotiation of drug prices principle as a part of Obamacare.
Unbelievable. You know, that's what's so important about this story. I'm part of me is glad that Martin Shkreli came out and did this to the price of a Daraprim last week, because it finally got the media to pay attention to something that you and I and everyone else on this show has been talking about for years. And that is the fact that Big Pharma is getting away with you know, doing what Martin Shkreli did on a daily basis. And everybody needs to pay attention. They need to understand that this is industry-wide, and it's not going to stop unless we get public pressure and we get a government that's willing to stand up to the Big Pharma lobby. We're out of time, but Howard, thank you very much for telling us this story today.
My pleasure, Farron. Thanks.
RingofFireRadio.com. Honest, hard-hitting news, free from corporate influence. Your destination for progressive news, commentary, and interviews. RingofFireRadio.com.
It was no surprise when Eric Holder went back to private practice to defend banking criminals, and it gave us a clear idea of why he never prosecuted a single banker during his run as Attorney General. His decision not to take action against banks like UBS led to massive economic collapse in Puerto Rico. And you know what? It affects us here on the mainland in a very big way. I have Attorney Peter Maget with me now to explain what happened. Peter, National Trial Lawyer magazine just did an article on you, your work, and the impact that you're having nationally on going after Wall Street. It's remarkable. Kudos to you. And I'm proud to know you're my partner, but it's such an interesting development that private industry is having to take over where government has dropped the ball. You're right now asked to lead the charge down in Puerto Rico for one of the worst frauds I've seen in quite some time, and that's saying a lot. Tell the viewers what's happened.
They are $72 billion worth of debt in Puerto Rico, and that's billions. $72 billion on an island with 3.6 million people. The population is declining day by day. A combination of the decreasing population base, the lack of industry, and $72 billion worth of debt has crippled the island. They can't pay their debt. The governor came out within the last 10 days and said, it's simple math. We don't have the money to pay the debt. And this is just decades of mismanagement and bad advice by Wall Street firms like UBS that are just riddled with conflicts of interest, that have given the Puerto Rican government, its bond distributing agencies, conflicted advice, issue more bonds that they can generate underwriting fees. They can stuff them in their own mutual funds. They can stuff them in their own closed-end funds and sell them to their own clients. And as a result, there is more debt in Puerto Rico than there is in almost any state in the United States. They just can't pay it, and it's a travesty.
Let's break it down. Let's move the dollar through the system and the corruption that you've found step by step in baby steps. So
let's start with, I tell you, the best example is the retirement system in Puerto Rico. It's called ERS, the Employees Retirement System. It's the government retirement system. It is the biggest one on the island, and it's chronically underfunded. UBS came in 2008, and this is a picture-perfect example of the conflict. So UBS came in 2008, and they were consultant to the retirement system. Retirement system doesn't have enough money to pay its bills. It is the worst underfunded system in the entire mainland United States, any state, any commonwealth, by 200 or 300%. I mean, just disastrous, worse than anything in Detroit and Michigan.
What did they do with the money?
So
why
UBS,
was it underfunded?
What they were doing with the money for the retirement system is they'd issued what you called POBs, pension obligation bonds. And it's essentially like borrowing money to pay your bills. But it's just like credit card debt. Once you keep stacking the debt, your bills keep getting bigger to pay the interest. It's a temporary fix. It's a Band-Aid. So UBS comes in as the consultant to the retirement system, and they said, hey, I'll tell you what, here's how you can get out of this problem for now. Issue these pension obligation bonds, $2 billion. UBS knows that they can underwrite those bonds. They take the project back to the mainland U.S. to sell the $2 billion. The problem was they can't sell it. There's no demand, so they go
Peter,
back.
Did they know that they couldn't sell it when they wrote the bond? Did they understood that this? Well, they understood from day one this was a scam.
Day one, they took it back to U.S. mainland, couldn't sell it. So they come back to the island and they say, we're going to change the deal. They actually changed the offering documents so they could only be sold on the island. About $1.7 billion of the $2 billion in pension obligation bonds that UBS is the consultant on, they underwrite and then sell to their own clients in their mutual funds. They stuff them in the mutual funds. They sell liquid, well-performing bonds.
Okay, let me let me stop you right there. Now, with this step, we've moved away from uniquely the Puerto Rican impact.
Right.
We've moved to the mainland, and mom and pop now is buying this garbage. Is that
It's close. Mom and pop are buying it, excepting for only Puerto Rican mom and pops are buying it.
Okay.
So they took this $2 billion UBS, stuffed it in the funds, and then sold it to their own clients. And that's where the conflicts come in, because their UBS is acting as a consultant to the retirement system. Now they're underwriters on the bonds, and they're also managers of the closed-end funds, and they're financial advisors to their own clients. There's four different hats, many hats, all generating fees at every single level. They don't care whether or not the bonds perform. They're generating the fees, stuffing them in their funds, and selling them to their own
clients.
Was
it just UBS, or is this kind of a free-for-all?
This is an example. I'd call it more of a free-for-all. It's an example of Wall Street coming down and providing, you know, unconflicted advice, objective advice to these entities generating these bonds, creating the bonds, selling the bonds. And the advice is so conflict-ridden that the answer is always issue more debt to an island that can't afford to pay its bills
already. Next question. Tell the viewers why this matters to them if they're on the mainland. What are the issues here?
It's the same impact as like a Greece will have. It scares the markets. It jitters the markets. Every one of these stories that hits, it causes gyrations. It puts fear into mainland investors. A lot of these bonds are in mainland investment mutual funds in percentages. So everything is given the market shakes, is given the market jitters. The ripple effect will cause problems in the U.S. market. How many papers, newspapers have you picked up and read about Greece? Greece is a tiny little island similar to Puerto Rico. What kind of impact has Greece had in the mainland U.S.? You're going to have the exact same problems with Puerto Rico in addition to just the loss of the bonds.
We can guess the answer about this, but why don't you tell the viewers what the U.S. Justice Department has done from criminal side investigation on this case?
Once again, it's just absolutely, there's nothing there. The SEC came in, settled the case with UBS. Then they tried a couple cases against the chairman of the bonds. Those cases failed. But as far as hardline driving litigation, criminal investigations, it's crickets. It's absolutely nothing.
Is there any question? I don't think I could ask a more of a specialist than you, and I'm proud to be able to say that because you're my partner. But is there any question that this is criminal conduct?
I have zero question that the DOJ should be all over UBS. They should be sending out inquiries, getting documents, and same thing we're doing. Here's Peter Mouget. We represent almost 300 individual investors with over $100 million in losses, in large part FINRA arbitration, gathering these documents, studying the bonds, studying the conflicts, who knew what when. There was a secret recording that came out in 2011 that was recorded by one of the financial advisors during a sales meeting. And the recording came out just here in the last few months. And what the recording revealed is that the chairman of UBS Puerto Rico was pushing just F-bomb laden speech to his financial advisors, telling them to sell the product or go home.
Push
get
the garbage.
Another job.
Peter, we're out of time. Unbelievable. I'm glad you're down there. I hope you can pull them out of it. It's just another ugly Wall Street story that the DOJ does
Absolutely.
Nothing about. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
And that's all the time we have for tonight, but you can get more news, video, and commentary on our website at ringoffireradio.com, and you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah. In 1980, 52 separate corporations owned the media, ranging from newspapers to magazines to television. TV media was considered a marketplace for important ideas and investigative stories. America had one of the most vibrant media infrastructures in the world. Today, five multi-conglomerate corporations own all the media, all the TV, all the radio, the newspapers, and the magazines. The truth is, meaningful reporting has died. It's created a window, a void that can be occupied by outlets like Free Speech TV, where advertisers and powerful politicos and MBAs don't tell us what we can or cannot report. Corporate media is dead or dying. But truth-teller outlets like Free Speech TV, well, they're now just being born. So here's the problem. If you want reporting that's not controlled by a corporate-owned and dominated CEO, if you believe you deserve a sincere reporting outlet that has no allegiance to a political party, if you understand that our democracy requires diversity and truthfulness, it requires courage, and it requires commitment to telling the whole truth about wars, telling the truth about our economy or corporate corruption, or the truth about our environment. If you understand that correlation, then you must understand that you're in control of all of that. Not the Beltway, not Wall Street, not Madison Avenue. You are in control of empowering Free Speech TV by giving us financial support, the tools to do what we promise to do for you every day, right here on Ring of Fire, for example, 5 days a week. My pledge to you is that not a dollar is going to be wasted. Every dollar you pledge to Free Speech TV is going to be honored as your commitment to change news reporting right here. Right now, that you can do that by supporting what we do. The truth is, we're a family here at Free Speech TV who cares for, believes in, and advocates for what you believe in every day. I'm asking for your financial support to allow us to do our job the way you deserve, to do our job the way you expect us to do. Go online to freespeech.org to help keep honest, independent media on the air. In the truest sense, Free Speech TV has the potential to be our line in the sand, a statement that TV reporting does have the capacity to create the kind of outrage that puts Wall Street white-collar criminals in prison once and for all. You see, your voice, and it is your voice that's delivered through Free Speech TV programming, and it really does have the potential outrage that demands that we save our planet from fossil fuel outlaws who are going to drill and frack until our grandchildren exist around irreversible environmental catastrophe. It's your voice. When you turn on Free Speech TV, you're going to hear your outrage, your demands articulated by some of the most important voices in progressive media. Tom Hartman or Amy Goodman, real journalists who have devoted their lives to being your voice for your causes. It is your voice that stays alive if you believe what you think every day. It's your voice, what you believe every day, what you're committed to every day, can show up on a network like Free Speech TV. Your voice delivered on a sustainable TV outlet unlike any other network. It is your voice that kept us out of a war in Syria, ladies and gentlemen. It's your voice that saved the internet from corporate media control. It was your voice, your outrage, that forced Obama time after time to do what he was unwilling to do at first. Free Speech TV, simply put, is your voice. Believe that your voice, your beliefs are important enough to be heard. And I promise you, I will speak your voice. But to do that, I need your help. Go to freespeech.org and help preserve your voice in the national media.